Breaking the sound barrier was difficult and dangerous, and brave men died in the attempt.
I'm Bruce Gordon. You may think that when Chuck Yaeger broke the sound barrier in the Bell X-1 in 1947, it was just a matter of finally having enough power to push an aircraft that fast. In reality, it was a tremendous step forward in our understanding of aviation and had a significant impact upon the Korean War.
In World War II, our fastest fighters, but especially the P-38, could get into such fast dives that they couldn't pull out. When the pilot pulled back on the stick, instead of pulling out, the dive got steeper. They called it compressibility, but it was a killer. They even had a song about it. Don't give me a P-38 with props that counter-rotate. They dived in that crate and they all pulled out late. Don't give me a P-38. Just give me operations way out on some lonely atoll. For I am too young to die. I just want to grow old. We later called this the sound barrier. Our high-speed photography was rapidly improving, and we got this photo of a bullet going supersonic, and for the first time, we saw the shock waves. We realized that if you swept the wings back, you could stay inside the shock wave and go faster without getting that extra drag. Our first jet fighter was the P-80. It had straight wings, and at about 0.73 Mach, it would have control difficulties and it couldn't go over 0.8 Mach. The Russians were ahead of us. When the Korean War started, their MiG-15 was faster than our P-80, and we rushed our new F-86 into combat. 3 years before the start of the Korean War, Chuck Yaeger had broken the sound barrier in the Bell X-1. It was kept secret for several years because of the things we learned that we were applying to the design of our new airplane, the F-86. Chuck Yaeger reported losing elevator control just before he went supersonic and regaining it after he was supersonic. We determined that the elevator was putting so much pressure on the horizontal stabilizer that it was twisting. This was presenting a control reversal where when the pilot pulled the stick back, the aircraft went down. Our secret fix was a slab elevator. Notice there is no elevator separate from the horizontal stabilizer. The entire thing moved as a unit, and we put this design into the F-86. With the slab elevator, the F-86 was able to dive faster than the MiGs. We could dive to attack them or dive to get away from them, and they couldn't catch us. We could maintain good control at very close to the speed of sound, and the MiGs could not. This was one of the reasons that we had an almost 10-to-1 kill ratio over the MiGs in Korea. By the time I flew the F-86, we could go supersonic, but only in a straight-down dive. A few years later, I was flying the F-106 and could go twice the speed of sound in level flight. But notice we were back to elevators again, although they were attached to the delta wing, and the wing would not twist, but the elevators weren't big enough to handle fighter tactics. Highly swept wings were not good for hard maneuvering at low speeds as in fighter tactics. We discovered that if you kept the wings short enough, they would stay inside the shock wave, and we put big elevators far back so they had plenty of leverage for hard turns at both high and low speeds. Our latest fighters have the design characteristics developed as a result of Chuck Yaeger's pioneering flight in the Bell X-1, the F-15, the F-22, and the F-35 all have the solid slab elevator developed and first used in our F-86 in Korea. Chuck Yaeger had the right stuff. He had the spirit of attack.